Just hit record there. So today's webinar will be recorded and it will be on our YouTube channel probably within sometime later this afternoon. It just takes a little while to process, get it online. Make sure you do go to our YouTube channel just to see what some of the other topics are that we've just done the 1 hour webinars. There's a lot of tax season ideas there just to make us more efficient, to make us more profitable, reduce the headaches or reduce some of the headaches, and then hopefully just get out of the office a little bit earlier this year. We obviously want to say thank you to our sponsors there that have supported us for the webinar program. And if you do have any questions about today's webinar, please just pop those into the question section on the GoToMeeting control panel. And of course, we'll have some polls throughout today's webinar just to get some of your feedback and also to make sure you're paying attention. So let's get going. 7 of the best marketing ideas. We are big fans of marketing during tax season, and I know a lot of people, whenever we say this in front of seminar attendees or in front of firms that we're consulting with, they look at us with fear in their eyes, because the thought of, my goodness, not only getting tax season done for our current clients, you want us to market for new clients, are you crazy? But we've got to think about it from the eye of our customer. When is the best time to be marketing our tax services? Tax season. So, and we see it now as well, if we look at some of the other, not to say that we want to compare ourselves to them, but H&R Block and TurboTax and some of the other organizations, they're not marketing any time other than this time throughout the year. So we do have to take a lesson from some of those folks. As I said, we're not necessarily looking for the 1040 Easies or a H&R Block type client, but we can leverage their marketing efforts with our own, so that with taxes and with tax matters being on people's minds, then we can play on that and implement our own marketing plan so as to attract the type of clients that we're looking for. And I'd imagine because you're on today's webinar, you're not going to say no to the idea of marketing during tax season. Some of these ideas require a little bit more investment, a few more resources than others, but some of them are free and some of them can get going. You can get at least started on it as soon as this webinar finishes. But what I really want to emphasize is before we do go down the path of marketing, business development, let's just take a step back and say, well, how much do we want to grow this tax season? And just do this tax season. Let's not necessarily think about how much do we want to grow this year, but what would be a successful tax season for us if we were thinking about growth? So what are our goals for this tax season from a new client perspective? How many new clients would we like to win? How many new clients at what revenue dollar would we like to bring them in at? Because it's one thing, do you want to bring in, let's just say, 10 clients at $100, and obviously that's not realistic, but 10 clients at $100 or one client at $1,000? What do we need to be providing to get that $1,000 fee? So we do need to take a step back and say, what are our goals for this tax season? Because once we have those goals, we can then work backwards, so to speak, and create an action plan of what are we going to do, who are we going to do it, and when do we need it to be done by. So that's really key in terms of our marketing plan. Let's just not go down the path willy-nilly and throw dollars at marketing with no real goal in mind. Let's have a goal, and it could be 10 clients at $500. That might be your goal, and if that's your goal, that's fine, but we definitely need to have those goals in place. And so let's get some feedback from the attendees with one of our polls, and let us know how many new clients would you like to add this tax season. And you've got to think about it as well as how many clients would you like to add, but also how many clients do you have the capacity to add as well. So it's an interesting question when we ask that. Just 1 to 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 plus new clients. As you're doing that, what I'd also like you to do, folks, is put in that in the question and answer box. You've answered 1 to 10, 11 to 20, or 21 to 30. Give me some feedback in terms of what would you like the average value of that client to be. So if you want 1 to 10 clients, I want, at what value do you want them coming in the door? 1 to 10 clients at $350 per client. 1 to 10 clients at $1,500 per client. Just give us some feedback there in the question and answer box or the chat section there, just so that we can see who, we've only got 70% voted, so a couple of folks are not paying attention, ducked out for some nicotine or caffeine already. So, okay, we've got Patrice, we've got 11 to 20 at $150 a client. Kevin said 1 to 10 clients at $1,500 per client. So it's really interesting that we do have quite a cross-section in terms of what our average transaction value is. Jerry has said $1,500 or $1,550 per client. 11 to 20 at $750. Thanks very much, Barry. So that's really good. So now that we've got that, we can then create a bit of a marketing plan to sit around that. And a couple of the ideas here, I would suggest that I'll close that poll and I'll share it with everybody. Let's share it. I'd suggest with just some sort of dedicated marketing, we can get ourselves up into the 21 to 30 clients, easily 11 to 20 with just some marketing. We typically, in our own accounting firm here, tax season is a big one for us, and we're looking for 21, well, we'd be happy with 35 or more. That's typically what we pick up each tax season, about 35 new individual clients, and they come in at about $950 per return. So that's a good tax season for us. So I'd suggest that if you do want to grow, this is the perfect time to do it. We don't have to do a lot of marketing, but we just need to have a plan around it, and then we've got to get things done. We've got to identify who's going to do it, what we're going to do, and when we're going to do it by. And given that we're already at the end of January, we've got to get started pretty quickly. So here's our first of the best marketing ideas. Direct mail, it works, particularly this time of year. Direct mail may have limited success at different times of the year, but as I said, given the timing and given all the other marketing that's going on around tax season, because we have the news channels covering it, the business news channels, H&R Block, John C. Reilly's telling people about tax season. So this is the perfect time to be doing it. But if we're going to do direct mail, I really want to emphasize that it's got to be consistent. I don't want you to go to a listing company and buy 5,000 addresses and do one mailing. I would love you to buy 100 addresses and do 5 mailings. I'd love you to buy 500 addresses and do 5 mailings. So when we do think about our marketing, think about our budget, but what I want to do is I want to drip on people. And if it's a decision between number of addresses and number of pieces of mail, so as in number of cont per address, I want more contact points per address, per prospective client, than sheer volume. So think about that from your marketing standpoint, and whether that's direct mail to businesses, direct mail to new homeowners or individuals, I would much rather 5 pieces to 100 prospects than 500 pieces to 500 prospects. So that's really key, because what we've got to be thinking of is this satisfaction curve that I'm sure none of your clients have, but your prospective clients have. This is satisfaction with their current CPA. Granted that some prospects may have just moved into the area, they know that their situation may have gotten a little bit more sophisticated, so they do need a CPA. But what we've got to be doing is we've got to be dripping on our prospective clients so that we get some name recognition, some branding recognition. And what we'll find is that we can't expect any results if we send out 5,000 letters, put our feet up and wait for the phone to ring. That's not going to work, because there's going to be no brand recognition, no name recognition. So we've got to be dripping on folks. We've got to be dripping on them, and knowing that, sometimes we'll drip on them, and they're not going to take our message. They're not going to read our message. They're not going to absorb our message. But other times, when they're dissatisfied with their current CPA, maybe they missed a tax credit, maybe an unexpected bill came, an IRS notice came, or they just didn't return the call in a timely manner, that's when we want to make sure we've got material going out on a consistent basis so that we can pick folks up at various points on that satisfaction curve. So direct mail works, but it does need to be consistent. And it's almost as if we've come a full circle from a direct mail standpoint, because we went to email because that was cost effective. However, now you know yourselves the number of emails you get on a daily basis. The effectiveness of those emails is disappearing. So direct mail definitely does work, but it has to be consistent and it's got to be a long and steady program. One of our member firms out of Fresno, they recently picked up a $28,000 engagement who was bought into the sales pipeline in January of last year. So it's taken 12 months to move them through the sales cycle, but for a $28,000 client, that's a nice return on investment. So direct mail works, consistent, and just think about that tap, dripping, dripping, dripping. We love good 1040 clients. I've got to be honest with you. And the reason that we love good 1040 clients is because we know that a good 1040 client will lead to wealth management in the fullness of time. So a lot of people sit in our seminars or maybe on today's webinar and think, oh God, I don't want more individuals. But we qualify that and say we want good individuals. And that's where we have an internal minimum from a pricing perspective that delineates a good client from a not a good client. And I don't mean not a good client as in they don't pay on time or they constantly complain. I just mean that it's not a good fit for us. So please don't think that we're snobs or anything along those lines. But our clientele is a clientele where we're looking after their wealth management. So have a look at yourselves as well in terms of your client selection criteria. Obviously, there's only a limited number of hours in the day. So we only really, and if we only want to bring on 20 clients, we want to make sure we're bringing on 20 clients at our top rate there. So what we do is we go to homeown.org. And we ask Barry down there, we say, Barry, can you give us the list of new homeowners within a 10-mile radius of our office? So we say we want a list of the new homeowners that have come into the area within the last 12 months within 10 miles of our office. Barry then sends us that list and we actually get the home values there as well. And what we do is we say, oh, Barry, what we know is that we don't necessarily want the first-time homeowner, because the first-time homeowner, it's typically this year we'll have some complexities in the tax return, but then they'll go back to TurboTax next year. So we want somebody, and we've decided we put the line at house values worth $800,000 or more, because typically that's a more sophisticated client that's going to have some wealth management needs. That's what we're looking for. So we can narrow the list down, and again, I don't want to waste my marketing dollars on the, say for example, the list came back at 1,500 people, but there was 600 of those less than $800,000. I don't want to waste my marketing dollars trying to attract those, because history has told me they're not a good fit. So we can target our list and narrow it and be more specific. So once we do have the list, we've then got to follow the program. Our letter, our tax organizer, is our first letter that's going out. We're organizing it all now, so it'll go out in early February, which will be next week. So folks, you still do have time, but we've got to get on it today, tomorrow, this weekend. And what goes out is a four-page tax organizer. And 2020 Premium members, you can log on and get the four-page tax organizer. And what we've done is it's just bifold. So it folds down to a size 10 envelope. We send that out to all of the new homeowners. Here is your free tax organizer. It'll help organize your tax information and make sure you don't miss any important deductions. Whether you do your own tax return or use the services of a CPA firm like ours, we hope you'll find it useful. So this is the first piece that goes out, and as I said, that'll hit sometime between now and February 10. And the good thing about that is we'll be hitting at the time when the more sophisticated clients are starting to get some K-1s in, starting to get the first version of the brokerage statements, starting to get some 1099s in. So that's what we're looking for, and why mailing it out in the first couple of weeks of February is ideal for us. So that goes out to the prospective clients, actually goes out to our current clients as well with a post-it note on it that says, if you know of anyone that needs help with their taxes, please let us know. We also send it to our previous new homeowners lists as well, and it's really just a reminder. It's often if they've just moved into the county, they might use their old CPA for last year's return, and now that they're and we I saw an announcement on one of our local LinkedIn groups that they moved from Chicago and they're looking for a local CPA to help them, given that they've been in California for a full 12 months now. So really good opportunity for last year's list, this year's list, but we get out the free tax organizer. Do not say, go to our website to download one. Call for a free tax organizer. They won't do it. Whereas when this arrives in the mail, it definitely gets it in front of them, gets our name in front of them, and gets them thinking about their taxes. And we got 1,000 printed, I think, came at cost about $500, $600. So not a bad, not an expensive marketing piece, but we get it out to everyone, and this does produce quality results. Our second letter goes out in March, on March 1st, and it's a tax time reminder. And again, the 2020 premium members, you have all these letters in the Accountant's Direct Marketing Kit, so you can just copy and paste those onto your letterhead, and away you go. That could be a postcard, could be a letter, depends on what you want to do. Have a look at the expenses, but we've definitely got some time to get that one teed up. And the letter just goes along the lines of, if you haven't started thinking about your taxes, then there's still time. And we go into our value proposition, particularly that we quote fees over the phone, etc. Number three of the mailing campaign, so remember it's a mailing campaign, we've got to consistently do this. For results to occur, we have to follow the program. Goes out on April 1st. Could you imagine marketing on April 1st? But we pick up some of our best clients between between April 1 and April 15. And it really, this is just a postcard, and it just says, get in here now. There's still time, but you must get in here now. And I know some of you are thinking, oh, you've got to be joking, marketing on April 1st, because the only people that are still looking for their taxes to be done on April 1st are the most disorganized. Yes and no. That's why we have a screening process, which we're about to talk about, to make sure we do screen those folks out. But we get some good doctors. We get some good executives that have just been running around getting the taxes done for their business or whatever it is, and they just haven't had time to deal with it. So we do get some good clients. As I said, the next aspect of this whole direct mail campaign of marketing on April 1st is having a good screening process. And this is the second best idea for marketing during tax season. Quote fees over the phone. This is a huge differentiator. You will get more clients out of your ability to quote a fee over the phone than most of your other marketing activities, because it solves a massive frustration. No other accounting firm does it, or very few other accounting firms do it. And in fact, you can test it. Call up three accounting firms in your area and just say, oh, look, just calling to see how much a tax return costs. This is how the conversation's going to go. Well, it depends. Well, no, first of all, it's going to have to go through to a partner, and that'll typically end up in voicemail, and who knows if the partner will even call them back. We often get that feedback that, yeah, I've called two other accounting firms and I haven't even heard back from them 3 days later. So once a partner does actually call them back, it typically goes along these lines. Well, it depends. What does it depend on? It depends on how long it's going to take. Well, how long should my tax return take? Well, that depends. So you can see this huge frustration from a client's perspective that, why can't they quote me a fee over the phone? This is ridiculous. Have they never done a tax return before? And then the CPA says, look, why don't you bring in last year's return, bring in all of your information, and then I'll be able to get a better idea and give you a sense of what's going on. It's not going to happen. The client is not going to get all, or the prospective client is not going to get all their papers together, come in, sit down with you, and then have a discussion as to whether or not this tax return is going to happen. So we empower everyone in our firm to quote a fee over the phone. And the reason that we're able to do that is we set an internal minimum, and then we have a script, and then we do lots and lots of training. where we say, we'd be delighted to quote you a fee over the phone. Is it possible that we can ask you a few questions to get a better understanding of your tax situation so that we can quote said fee? And then we go down the script, and it's an Excel spreadsheet. And again, 2020 Premium members, you've got access to this online. We go down the script, and we ask the various questions associated with a typical tax return. Do you have rental income? Do you have any interest income? Do you have a Schedule C, your own business? How many states are you filing in? So we go down this this script asking the questions. Our team fills in the spreadsheet, and then once we've got to the bottom of the script, it basically gives us a number that we're able to say, Kim, based on what you've told me, the tax return will come in at about $850. How do you feel about setting an appointment to confirm everything that we've got and get started on preparing your tax returns? Really interesting. And typically out of 10 calls, 4 calls say, yeah, let's set up an appointment. 6 calls, 6 prospective clients say, oh, that sounds a bit expensive to me. Thanks very much for your time. It probably isn't a good fit for us. And when that does come up, I say, well, look, I certainly understand that. Let me introduce you to Georgia, who shares an office with us. Let me introduce you to Bob up the road, who might be better suited to help you. Really nice CPA, really nice enrolled agent, do great work. And if it's okay, can I give you their number? The 4 people that come in, we typically hit three out of those 4 become clients because they come in, they know what they're paying. We also have an opportunity to confirm everything that they've said. So sometimes it's come in the situation on the spreadsheet, it says 1 rental property, but in the conversation we've got 15 rental properties. That's where the partner says, oh, Kim, I know when you spoke with Ina, she asked you about rental property income, and her understanding was there was just 1 rental property, but looking at your information, we've got 15 rental properties. In short, that quote is null and void. The new quote would be $1,800 or whatever it is. So that's where we've got, based on, would you like to set an appointment to confirm that we have everything, that we have a full understanding, that we have all the information that we need. Let's ask a poll. Do you quote fees over the phone currently? And then let me know, yes, everyone can. Yes, the more senior people can quote fees over the phone. Only the partners can quote a fee over the phone. And no. Let me know whether you currently quote fees over the phone. But I'll tell you that we get some of the best feedback as a result of our ability to quote a fee over the phone. And I've got to be honest, once we've got some good training in place, whether it's Christine on the front desk, Carol on the front desk, me, Tara, Chris, we typically get close. So let's close that poll. We've got a lot of stuff to get through, and I'll share that with everyone. Only a third have said yes, or senior people can do it. We've got the other third have said only partners do, and I wonder if some of you were nodding along because you don't get around to calling all those people back. You don't get around to phoning those messages back or returning people's call in a timely manner, because what they've done is they've got 3 CPAs that they've called. They've gone to Google to find 3 CPAs. They've gone to Yelp to find a couple of CPAs. If you don't call them back within 1 hour, 2 hours, they're on to the next one. So they've moved on quickly. So if we don't have a system in place to quote a fee over the phone, we're missing out. Train. Understand that you'll get the first one wrong. Understand that you'll get the second one less wrong. And what you'll find is that your clients, your prospective clients, the people coming in for that free consultation are a much higher level than before. So what I'd encourage you to do is between now and when the phone starts ringing, and it'll probably start within the next week or two, about how much for a tax return, let's get training and let's get everyone in the office able to quote a fee over the phone. Or alternatively, if not everybody, maybe we've got our new hire or our second hire, they may not want to be on that front line just yet, but let's make sure we cast a wider net of people that are able to quote fees over the phone, because that will make a huge difference. So number three, we did direct mail to homeowners. Now we're doing direct mail to business owners. This is a great time to be mailing to business owners as well. So go to your local associations, join the Agriculture Association, the Contractors Association, get the lists, and let's start dripping on people. But remember, we've got to be different. What is the offer? What's the call to action? A one-hour free consultation isn't going to cut it, because I know in a one-hour consultation, you're going to try to sell me something. So I'm not, and the other thing is, I probably don't even have an hour to spare. I'm going so quickly running my small, medium-sized business. I don't have an hour to stop. So how are we going to be different? Tax planning, we probably missed the opportunity. Well, we have missed the opportunity for that, but it might be a second look. We might offer a second look at a tax return to say, look, another set of eyes might identify some tax credits, some opportunities for additional tax savings. So feel free to give us a call. As members of the Agriculture Association, feel free to give us a call for a second look at your tax return. What I've got down here, call now for your free copy of 57 Ways to Grow the Business. This is probably our most successful marketing piece, because it's a book that's published by ourselves that's focused on growing the business. It's not about how great we are as CPAs. It's not about how we've got 700 years of combined experience in our office. It's about helping you grow your business. And it's a free book that we publish. To publish it, per book costs about $2.20 through CreateSpace. And if you want to know how you can get your own book published, give us a call, because we'll provide the content, we'll provide the content, we'll get it published for you, and we'll get you up and running with your own 57 Ways to Grow Your Business, which is one of our best response items for for direct mail. P.S. Call now for your free 57 Ways to Grow Your Business. We get a call for those, and we're out in the car to drop that by very quickly. So when we do direct mail to business owners, it's got to be different. It's really got to focus on the client, what they're interested in. And as I said, premium members, you've got the Accountants Direct Marketing Kit, so you've got 150-odd letters that you're able to use in your direct marketing campaign. So don't think that you've got to sit down and write a ridiculous number of letters. But again, the goal is to drip, drip, drip on everybody, so that we ideally become number two in the eyes of our prospective clients. So what we want to do is we want to be number two, so when the current client, when the current CPA lets them down, we are the first person that they think of. So direct mail to business owners, great time of the year to be doing it, offering you a free QuickBooks review, a free QuickBooks assessment, a free QuickBooks analysis. If you're subscribing to ProfitSense, call now for your free data or industry analysis. Call now for your free performance review. Those are wonderful freebies, call to actions, that are so much better, so much more productive than free consultations. So if anyone is a subscriber to ProfitSense, that industry analysis, wonderful example of a great freebie. And just get that out to everyone. Get that out to your referral sources, to your prospective clients, to whomever might be interested in that. And don't underestimate who you think would be interested. Our theory is get it out to everyone, because you never know who somebody knows. So that's number three. Number four, we got to get social. And I know some folks are sitting here thinking, oh, another person talking about social media. I can't handle it. I prefer to stick my head in the sand and just wait for it all to go away. The unfortunate thing is it's not going to go away. And I'm not suggesting that because you have a Twitter profile, the phone is going to start ringing. But what we want to do is we want to be where our clients and our prospective clients get their information. So I'll be honest with you, 2 years ago, loved the Facebook, quite enjoyed it. Twitter, thought it was a waste of time. Whereas Twitter now, I go to find out what's going on in the accounting profession. I don't go to Accounting Today. I don't go to the Journal of Accountancy. I go to see what the thought leaders are reading, what the thought leaders are focusing on, what the providers are doing in the marketplace. That's where I get my news about the accounting profession. And I would hazard a guess that a proportion of your clients are doing the same thing. So we've got to be where our clients are going for news and views. The beautiful thing about social media and this, what we call outbound marketing, or no, inbound marketing rather, the vast majority of the platforms are free. And I would suggest you can get a really good social media program up and running in 10 minutes per day, tops. And all we want to do to get started, we want to follow, promote, share, update, and remind. And so all we're doing is following our current clients, following our referral sources, following our prospective clients. Because when you follow your prospective clients, businesses, let's just keep it with businesses at this stage, when you follow a prospective client, that client gets an email that says, Fredrickson Crawford CPAs is now following you. Or Fredrickson and Crawford CPAs shared your article. Fredrickson Crawford liked your article. So what we're doing inadvertently is, again, dripping on our prospective clients, dripping on our current clients, dripping on our referral sources to say, wow, my CPA, my accountant is thinking of me. They get that email to say, my CPA is thinking of me. So we've actually gone in and systemized it. So we have got to follow, share, update, like 10 to 15 clients' prospective referral sources a week. So with a client list of and prospect and referral sources of a couple of hundred, what's happening is every month or so, our prospective clients, referral sources, current clients are getting reminded that we're doing something for them. So not only are we sharing interesting articles, but we're also helping to grow their business. So if I had 10 minutes a day, all I want to do is share, update, follow, and promote. And let's have another poll question just to make sure that we haven't lost anyone. Do your clients use social media to grow their businesses? I guess you'd put it in no if you're a predominantly an individual-based firm. But give us some feedback there. I haven't got 50% voted yet, so wake up, everybody, and let us know. Do your clients use social media to grow their business? So we've got about 80% voted now. Let's close that there. Let's share. So a third have said yes, so I would assume that third knows that they've got to be in social media. 7% have said no, so I'd hazard a guess we're in a highly regulated industry or our business base or our client base is predominantly individuals. And then 60%, a whopping two-thirds of the audience has said they're not sure, and that's an issue for me, and I would hazard a guess that a large percentage of your business clients are using social media, whether they're using it effectively, whether they know how to use it, they're trying to use social media to promote their business. And because we're not sure, I'm really worried about the people, the audience members that are hitting not sure. Let's ask our clients, let's find out. And if you're not sure, I would be pretty confident that they are using social media to grow their business. We have 400 members in our premium membership group. I know that our members are using social media to grow their business. Are all members? Obviously not. Without a doubt, no. But I know that I would hazard a guess maybe 30% of our audience is using social media to grow their business. That means I've got to be in social media. I've got to be on social media to make sure that I'm not missing out on an opportunity, because I guarantee you, if you're not using social media to stay in touch, to remind, to drip on, to promote, to share, someone else in another CPA firm is. So could you imagine what would happen if your client gets an email that says, ABC Accounting is now following you, ABC Accounting liked your update, ABC Accounting shared your update. Could you imagine what's going through their mind? Wow. my CPA is not following me, sharing me, promoting me, helping me grow my business. You know what? I'm not that tied to this, to my current CPA. Or alternatively, look, I might at least have a conversation with this person. No harm, no foul. So why not? So we've got to get social. One to two social media platforms. Where would we spend our 10 minutes per day? Let's go to LinkedIn. Much more professional. Let's get specific in our updates when we update our profile, because we are getting firms that are getting calls from prospective clients to say, I found you on LinkedIn because you have a specialty in real estate. I found you on LinkedIn because you specialized in restaurants. So let's get there and be specific. And that's what people are looking for. They're looking for people that can help their specific situation. Don't be the be-all and end-all of accounting, listing everything you've ever done in your lifetime, because that's too general. We want to be specific. If you read an interesting article during the day, just click that little button up the top of that article that says share. If you read something from Inc. magazine, the Harvard Business Review, Wall Street Journal, Sacramento Bee, the accounting journal, whatever it is, just click that little button up the top that says share. Do that once a day and you'll start to gain traction. So if you read something interesting, you think your client would find it interesting, just hit share. And all that does is it then just lands on their feed. Whether or not they pick that up, who knows, who cares, but you haven't done anything except click that share button. So if you've got 10 minutes a day, let's try and share one article a day. What we want to do is we want to find our colleagues, referral sources, and clients. Link with them. So if we're at a mixer, an association event, let's come home and if our 10 minutes per day for Thursday is, let's just look for those three business cards that I picked up from an association meeting. That's what I'm going to do with my 10 minutes, and I'm going to write them a note that says, hi Christine, lovely to meet you last night at the association thing, just wanted to connect with you and maybe we can see what opportunities might exist to work together. Then, once we're starting to get more comfortable with it, we want to make sure we join some forums, join some groups. And so here at the bottom, we've got some Construction Professionals Forum. There's 44,000 members there. And all we want to do is we want to get the daily digest from that group so that we can quickly scroll down. I've got 10 minutes a day, and so I'm going to get the weekly digest maybe. I can get a weekly digest from this group, and I'm just going to scroll down and see whether or not I can add value to any of the discussions going on. So if I have a construction specialty, if I have a restaurant specialty, I get the email and I scroll down, Liberty Accounts Bookkeeping, no interest. I have a client who is a UK resident but needs assistance with US taxes and US tax returns. Ding, ding, ding. This one should be jumping out of me. I click that, go straight to the discussion, and participate. Whether or not something comes from it, I have no idea, but I've at least participated. I might send them to my blog to let them know I specialize in international tax. There's other ways in which we might say, hi Christine, Philippa. Hi Philippa, just wanted to introduce myself, Damien Greater at Fredrickson Crawford CPAs. We've got a lot of clients in the UK and international tax issues. Here's a couple of interesting articles that we've put together to help our expatriate clients with US taxes. Let us know if we can be of assistance. So not only are we saying, hey, Philippa, give me a call, but we're also demonstrating our expertise just as if we're in a one-on-one environment. So that's really important. We want to try to replicate that one-on-one environment and demonstrate that we've got some expertise there rather than just saying, hey, Philippa, give us a call. We're looking to work with a business partner who specializes in international tax. Anybody out there? Hi Anne, Damien from Fredrickson Crawford CPAs. We're based in California and we've got a big international tax environment or tax client base. Here are some blog articles we've written. Here are some areas that we've been featured in local publications. Feel free to reach out. Let us know if there's anything that we can do. Delighted to spend 20, 30 minutes with you on the phone just to get a better understanding of your needs. So we want to do that. And I joined the local Marin County small business owners group. So there's probably a group for small business owners in your area, and we're seeing in that daily digest some tax questions coming through. As I said, there was the one, we moved from Chicago last year. Now that we're full-time residents in California, looking for a Marin County CPA, can anybody recommend anyone? Nice little discussion going on there. Also the situation of our current CPA just retired or sold his practice and we're looking for someone a little closer to home. Can anybody recommend somebody? So look at the groups that we can participate in to demonstrate expertise and be efficient with the daily, weekly digest. That's all we're looking to do. Endorse people, promote people, write good things about people, and then other folks will do that. Twitter, it's an easy way to regularly drip. Follow clients, prospects, referral sources. As I said, share articles, promote clients, promote referral sources, and use the tools. So for example, if there's four or five people in your office, you know that four or five people read interesting articles. Why don't you just send that to somebody in the office? And so on Monday, they can log into Hootsuite, free service, and schedule all of the shares and tweets. So, for example, I know that when we came in and into our own office, I'd typically read the news in the morning, or I'd be reading the news having breakfast, first cup of coffee, or on the morning break. That's when I do all my sharing. And what would happen is, all of a sudden, there'd just be this massive explode, well, not massive, really, maybe three shares of interesting things that I was reading, and then there'd be radio silence for the rest of the day. But with Hootsuite, I'm able to log in, manage all of my social media platforms from the one page. So I can do Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, all from the one platform, and then I can just schedule my announcements, schedule my article shares, schedule my sharing of clients, scheduling my liking of clients, whatever it is. I can schedule all that so that it happens every couple of hours, maybe every 3 or 4 hours, something goes out just to drip on people's subconsciousness. Whether people click on that, who knows? Well, you do know, because you can get some incredible reporting from the various platforms in terms of engagement. But what I've done here is I've just come in and I came into Hootsuite. I was reading what other folks are writing. Jim Burke, he said the IRS finalizes rules on additional Medicare tax. Oh, I like that. I'm going to share that. But I'm going to schedule it for just after lunch. So I was reading it at 9 o'clock this morning. I'm going to schedule it for after lunch. And then at 12:20 Pacific time, it's going to go out to all my various platforms. So that's what we want to do, is if we can systemize 80% of our social media and then personalize the other 20%, and we recognize that from Michael Gerber's E-Myth, if we can systemize 80%, personalize 20%, then it's not as if we've got to be spending hours upon hours upon hours doing this social media marketing, because based on what we do, based on the types of services we provide, this isn't, social media isn't going to be your number one way in which we do, way in which we grow our business. But we want to make sure we have a presence in these social media platforms, so when somebody does search for you, we have a big web footprint. We have other people saying good things about us. That's what's critical. We want to push the competition down the search engine rankings by having a big web presence. So search engine optimization is no longer about keywords in your website. It's really about it. Well, in addition to that, it's about what are other websites saying about you. And so when we build in LinkedIn, build in Twitter, that's when we start to build our web footprint. And as I said, we can do it in 10 minutes or less per day. So get networking. If you're having lunch at your desk during tax season, you're missing out on an opportunity. And I know, given that we've got to get the work out the door, we might just set an internal goal of maybe 2 lunches per week. And lunch could be breakfast, could be a cup of coffee, could be lunch, could be a drink after work, whatever it is. I need you out there networking. So whether that's taking a client to lunch, taking a referral source to lunch, because obviously your referral sources, this is the perfect opportunity for them to refer you. But if you're not top of mind, you're not top of mind. So what can we do to stay top of mind? And this is where we've got to get out, take somebody to lunch, go grab a cup of coffee, And it's what we've done now is in January, February, we've scheduled lunches in advance. So we're taking the bankers, we're taking our estate planning attorneys, we're getting involved, we're just making sure we're top of mind, checking in with folks, because this is their perfect referral time. So we want to make sure that we are on top of it. Business Networking International, BNI, or any of the networking groups, typically they're crying out for CPAs because during tax season, CPAs disappear out of the groups. But I know Dan on the East Coast. I know Michael in the East Bay here up in Northern California. They jump out of bed every Monday for that BNI meeting because they can identify $75,000 to $100,000 of new revenue to their business networking group. But you got to find the right group. Got to get the right group of people. You've got to find the right mix. You've got to realize that we're in it for the long term. We've also got to realize that we can say no to when the massage therapist is sending a $300 tax return and that's not for us. It also gives us the opportunity to really fine tune our pitch. What are we looking for? What's the type of client that we're looking for? So Business Networking International can work when we find the right group, we hone and fine tune our pitch, and we're consistent. It really falls off if we're not consistent. So a couple of firms, they send their junior CPAs, maybe their 3 and 4 year accountants studying for the CPA exam, because it's a great opportunity for them to practice their elevator speech. It's a great opportunity for them to get experience networking. So sit down with the team, find out if there's any Business Networking International chapters in your area that need a CPA, that need an accountant, get along. As I said, there's no real commitment at this stage, just to find out what the group's like. Come in and do a meet and greet. No harm, no foul. If it's not a good fit after 2 or 3 meetings, it's not a good fit. That's okay, but at least you've tried and we can try another group. So let's just see what groups are out there within a 10-15 mile radius of your home, home or office, whichever's easiest, because we want to make it convenient. Get along to some of the meetings. See if they're going to be a fit, but be conscious of your product that you're selling is a slightly bigger buying decision than maybe the electrician, than the plumber. So we've got to be cognizant that it's a longer buying cycle, so we do have to stick with it. But as I said, we've got members that jump out of bed every Monday because, as I said, big numbers as a result of their efforts with BNI. So, number 6, we've got to get others saying great things about you. And this is really testimonials 2.0. And again, this is a part of the way people are making buying decisions is having changed. So what are other people publicly saying about you? And this is where we start to take advantage of review sites. And what we're seeing, for example, is the rise of these review sites, because I can talk about how great my CPA firm is until I am blue in the face. A banker will recommend Fredrickson Crawford CPAs. They will throw that into the Google, and obviously, and I've got the example there, Fredrickson Crawford CPAs, thankfully, we've gone to Google Places, we've put in some photos, we've made sure our address is correct, our phone numbers are correct. So quick tip there, make sure you go to Google Places and get everything right. Get some pictures in there just to the office so that people can find you easily. But what's happening here is, yes, we come up first, so someone being referred might go there. But what else is there? Yelp.com. So Yelp.com is a review site, and it was finding a good restaurant, finding a good mechanic, but it's really gone the full spectrum now, and we're seeing people searching for CPAs on Yelp. And so why don't we have another poll? Do you have a Yelp profile? So let me launch that. Do you have a Yelp profile? A wonderful thing about Yelp is that it's free platform, so you can take advantage of that. The only caveat, the asterisk above, it's free. You do have to put up with the pay-per-click advertisers calling you for about 3 months to say, do you want to advertise on Yelp? Do you want to advertise on Yelp? Just say no. Please never call me again. But so just be aware that when you do claim your profile, you will start getting calls from Yelp that want to get you on a pay-per-click. We have never paid, we have never done pay-per-click, and we get 4 to 5 calls a day during tax season from our Yelp profile. So here's the feedback there. So only 50% have said no. Well, 71% have said no and what's Yelp. So what I want you to do, I want you to go to Yelp. I want you to search for your accounting firm in your city and find your profile. Yelp has a strong presence on the coasts in major metropolitan areas, and Yelp is one of, I think it's in the top 10 most trafficked websites, so that is going to be incredibly powerful for you from a search engine optimization standpoint. Even if you are in Sioux Falls, one of the Dakotas, if you're in a more rural area, claim the profile, get some photos on there, make sure the numbers are up to date, and then encourage your clients to write reviews for you. And so here's what happens when you come to our Yelp profile. So all of our information is up the front, but one of our clients, Sean W., wrote this review, and it says, "We moved to Marin and we're looking for a new accountant after my old accountant made a $30,000 mistake on last year's taxes. We're two professionals with some rental income and we bought and sold property this year, so our return was mildly complicated. Tara is exactly what I was looking for. I won't bore you with the rest, but a prospective client reads this, they're not calling another CPA firm. They're picking up the phone to say, I read your reviews on Yelp and it sounds like you're what I'm looking for. Or, I found you guys on Yelp, or the banker down the road recommended you, but I saw you guys on Yelp and I didn't even call the other folks." So this is what's happening. Where we can talk about how great we are till we're blue in the face, and obviously that may not necessarily be as effective messaging, whereas when Sean W. says that we're the best thing since sliced bread, clients are picking up the phone. So Yelp, free site, free platform, just tell the pay-per-click folks that want you to spend money with them to buzz off, and this, you will get phone calls from it. And I was with a firm doing some work with a firm down in Calabasas, and they said, "We can't keep up with the number of phone calls coming from our Yelp profile." So what we had to do there is we had to get people up to speed very quickly to be able to screen these phone calls. Because with just the sheer volume of them, what was happening is some of the partners were making calls on not well-suited, not qualified prospects. So now we've got people actually on the front line screening folks, making sure they're good fit before they go to schedule some time, just by the sheer volume. They've only got 3 reviews, and they asked the client to do it. So, and particularly a client that's in a restaurant business, that's in a service industry, they will know the benefit of Yelp. So, and these types of sites. So get on it. And as I said, we're getting calls. This review came in 2011, so I've got to get onto that and get some more up-to-date reviews. But when we get others saying great things about us, it's almost as if any other marketing piece fails in comparison these days. I talked the other day about Demandforce from a automate the scheduling and automate the meeting reminders process. The other side of Demandforce is really where you take control of this review process. So Yelp, that's an independent platform that you don't have much control over. Whereas Demandforce.com, you have control over this completely. So at the end of every engagement, when a client pays you, at the end of every meeting, something goes out just to say, "Thank you so much for being a client of Accounting Experts. We value you as a client. Let us know if there's any feedback as to how we can improve anything you'd like us, or give us some feedback." So then, out of the email, the client clicks provide feedback, and then opens up this review site where it says, "Share your experience with others on the web. Give us a rating out of 5, and provide us some feedback." So we're proactively getting feedback. This is important. I want to know if I've knocked the socks off a client and worthy of 5 stars, and I want to get that immediately, and I want to get their review I also want to know if I've missed the mark for any clients. So if I'm getting two, three, or one, two, or three stars, it means that I've missed the mark, and I want to rectify that or fix that as quickly as possible. So this immediate feedback loop is incredibly valuable, A, internally, to make sure you're hitting all the marks from your client service standpoint, but B, so we are in control of the reviews. We're actively promoting folks, and I know Chris Coggins did this, so this goes out to all clients. I'd hazard a guess that they probably get about 50% of, maybe less than that, maybe 40% give them a star rating. And then of that 40%, probably another 30 to 40% of those people that provide a rating actually go on to write a review. And then these reviews then get filtered out to Facebook, City Search, Bing, Bing Places, Google Places, so that we start to get a presence on more and more websites. Again, going on the SEO 2.0, sorry, I made that up, I don't think that's a real term, but search engine optimization is now shifting towards what are all the other websites saying about us, not just ourselves, so we're in control of that. Number seven of the best marketing tips, and so I've got actually two more. Number seven is, get a marketing assistant, and otherwise it won't happen, particularly during tax season. If you give marketing to your firm administrator, it's not going to happen during tax season. We need the consistency for it to be successful. So if you're a small firm, that could be somebody coming in 10 hours a week, two afternoons a week. That if you're in a larger firm with bigger growth expectations, that might be 20 hours a week. But you need to bring somebody in, and here's their job description. Their job description is to implement the plan, and so just choose whatever items you've got here, but we can fill up 10 hours very quickly per week. And if we're doing 10 hours per week, it could be a stay-at-home mum coming back into the workforce, could be a student, Christine, in our office. She's in 2 days a week. And then the other 3 days she's at university, so that works perfectly for us. And Christine is on $15 an hour. And there's a little bonus system there in place. But really nice that, Christine, here's the marketing plan. Do it and report back to me. It's done. It's getting done. We're seeing the results from our Google Analytics. Our website is getting more traction. We're getting more responses. The phone is ringing. So we are getting traction and the marketing is paying off. But if we don't have somebody in that dedicated role, it won't get done. Or it won't get done with the consistency that it needs to. So there's the job description there. And it really is at a base level, 10 hours a week to implement the plan. Given where we are now, coming into tax season, we can get this job description online, make that hire. You'd probably, we've found some folks actually just write out to their client base and say, hey, we're looking to hire a marketing person, really suits maybe a second or third year university student. So if one of your kids is looking for some extra work, we'd love to have them on board. Please send us. Please feel free to share this with them. Interestingly, if the kid's a dropout, this sounds terrible, their parents aren't going to recommend them, because if they know that their kid's not the most articulate or not the most best suited candidate, they won't recommend them, because they don't want it to reflect badly on them. So when we do go out to our clients, our experience has been, and the experience of members has been, they recommend good people. And I'd probably say that some of the best hires accounting firms have made have been from not headhunters, not recruiting on Monster, but just going out to their client base, going out to their social media platform. So that's the job description. Write the thank you cards, get the partners and managers to lunch, schedule the social media, update the website, which is my last point, and I know we've just come on time. First impressions count. You've got to go to your website and you've got to have a really hard look at that and say, is this the best first impression? Am I putting my best foot forward? Don't overload it with information. I go to a lot of websites and they are so verbose that if I was a prospective client, I'd either be asleep through sheer boredom, within the first paragraph, or I wouldn't know what we're talking about. So don't overload it with information. Read it through your client's eyes. Is your phone number easy to find? And we're just going to do our final poll. Just as we're talking about websites, give us some feedback. Is your phone number on the front page of your website? And I go to a lot of accounting firm websites and it's not. And the people that are replying with yes, I would double check, particularly if you've got one of those templated websites from CCH or Thompson. Sometimes people have to go looking for that website and it's a huge frustration. So let's close the poll. I know a few folks have got to head off here, but let's close that poll. I'll share it. Interestingly, we've got not sure, and at least a third are saying not sure or no. So, and I'd hazard a guess that some of those yes, they might not be so sure. So, is your phone number easy to find? How does it look on a device? We look at the stats, and we've got about 30% of internet traffic is now going through tablets and smartphones. So how does it look on a device? Let's make sure we do that. Online, there are a couple of good examples. The wowcompany.com, Weeby Hinton Hambleck out of Fresno, and Jones and Roth out of Eugene, Oregon. Some really good examples of good quality websites. But have a look at it. Is this our best foot forward? Because the banker recommends you, a golfing buddy recommends you, they're always going to go to the internet the first time. So we've got to ask ourselves, is our website putting our best foot forward? And we might be able to identify three or four things that we can do now just to clean up the website. Maybe update some of the pictures, maybe update some of the colors, make sure our phone number and our email address is on the front page, make sure... maybe trim down some of the content. And when we do trim down content, we're looking at about 70% of the content off, because then it really becomes apparent for the reader as to what you do. So let's look at this, getting 30 to 50% of our content off the website so that it really cleans up our page. So there's a lot of white space, good images, make sure it's easy for people to find you. So folks, we finish up there. I've just gone slightly over, which I do apologize. I get excited about marketing and tax season. There's my contact information. Today's webinar was recorded. We'll get it up onto our YouTube channel probably within the day. So jump onto YouTube, search for 2020 Group USA, and there's a ton of other webinars up there to help tax season, to help marketing, to help efficiency, practice management, etc. And then, of course, I will send out the slides from today's webinar once I get the attendee report. So probably within 2 hours, you'll get the slides. Any questions, you've got my contact details there. Give me a call. Love to spend 20 minutes with you on the phone to strategize about marketing. And then CPE, that'll come out for all of this week's webinars, most likely tomorrow. So if you're a 2020 member, premium member, that'll come. If you're not a premium member, you'll get an invoice for $10. For the CPE certificate. If you don't need CPE, just ignore that, and we'll get those out to everybody. But folks, have a wonderful afternoon. Best of luck for tax season. Look forward to connecting with you either during tax season or shortly after. Let us know what we can do to help. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Have a wonderful day.